So when this topic was like given to me, I was first like I first wanted to have a look what is an SME, because I had never like searched for the definition of an SME. When I went to search for the word SME, I like found there's another word called SMB as well. So like I was thinking, what the hell, what's SMB and SME? So that's a little different. The SMBs, the small and medium scale businesses and small and medium scale enterprises, they have a little different. So I'll talk the difference in terms of the IT side. So most of the times, the businesses, the medium-scale businesses, they don't have a permanent set of IT staff. Most of the times, like they have like part-time workers, which plays different roles, like one person playing multiple roles. And in the for the SMEs, they have some sort of a concrete staff, but they are not like the gurus. Their skill set is not very deep. So. So first of all, like I wanted to like emphasize what's the necessity of IT for the SMEs. Now let's take a small business. Like they might be running with some traditional approaches. For example, they are they'll be like talking to their customers through the newspaper ads and the phone calls and those kind of things. So they might need to reach a broader audience, because now the world is changing, and like the customers or the users, they expect everything to be at their fingertips. So the business might want to reach to a broader audience. Then when doing that, the traditional ways might not be enough. The other thing is they want to improve the user experience, because by improving the user experience, you can attract more users. And another reason might be reducing the operational cost. So a given business might be like running with a lot of manual work. So they might be keeping their data in the files or Excel sheets, those kind of things. So they might want to reduce such things. And also, they want to reduce, let's say, if two people are needed for a certain task, they would like to reduce it to one to reduce the cost. So the challenges on doing this, so there are a set of challenges. One is the liability of maintaining an IT staff. So I mentioned that the skill set of the IT staff in SME is not very deep. So if they want to hire highly skilled, talented staff, they will have to pay more, and that becomes a liability. And the other thing is, so I mentioned about expertise. So let's say if somehow they gathered a staff, but now the problem is they have to develop solutions. So to develop the solutions, they again need some expertise. So they won't have those the tech leads and architects kind of guys. So that becomes a problem. And after somehow they develop the solution, then the problem is like where to host. Now we know from our university days, like when we wanted to host something, we had to maintain our own infrastructure and go through a lot of pain setting them up and all those things. So it's true that there are some hosting services, but they might not provide all the requirements you have. And the other thing is the infrastructure cost. And if your solution involves some software which needs to get a license, then that license fee will also be a problem to you. It might be high. So we know that when we buy some license for certain software, we know that they cost a lot. The other thing is time to market. So you need to build a solution and deploy it as quickly as possible. Another thing, so in the today's keynote also, Isabel mentioned that the importance of analytics. So even though you have a solution, you want to know how successful that is. For that, you need analytics. So when introducing the App Cloud and API Cloud, I thought of like coming up with a story. I tell this named this as John's story. So John runs a taxi service. It's a successful one. Let's say. I don't know in which country, but it's a successful one. He has enough business. But he's an innovative guy. He wants to expand his business. So when he was talking to some of his other colleagues, someone advises him to launch a website, because at the moment he was taking orders through phones, and he was like advertising through newspaper ads and little leaflets. So someone advises him to launch a website. So what John does is, so he has a couple of IT-related guys in his business. So he decides to hire a web developer named Bill. So this is Bill. So he joins this. He was recruited, and the task he was given is to develop a web app, which the users are allowed to book rides online. Because nowadays, like, we'd like to do things online. We buy tickets online. We do all the things in online. So if you take Sri Lanka, we have a lot of like online so websites to do these things like tickets LK, cabs LK, and all those things. So Bill develops this web app. He tests it locally. He shows it to John. Now he's looking for a place to host it. So he has certain requirements. So those are like the app should be available. That's a major requirement. So it should be available at least most of the time. Like I won't say it should be available 100% of the time, but it should be available most of the time. And it should handle the load. So normally a cab service it's not getting a lot of load, but whatever the request coming, it should be able to handle it. And it should also provide an acceptable performance. Like if you like when you try to book a ride, if it's like circling round and round in the UI without knowing what's happening, that's not acceptable performance. So Bill needed a database. He needs a database to persist data. He also wants a nice URL for his website. So at the moment, like at this time, Bill has convinced John to buy this domain called johnscabs.com, because like Bill is somewhat a talented guy with a vision. So he convinces John to buy the this domain. So now I'll step out from the story a little bit and talk a little bit about WS2 Cloud. So Imesh, in his previous talk, mentioned about the WS2 public cloud. So it's the public cloud offering from WS2, which now has been running for about 2 years. It has this app cloud and an API cloud. So about 90% of the products used in the WS2 cloud are WS2 middleware. We have a couple of other products such as Nginx for load balancing. So this is hosted in AWS infrastructure and maintained by WS2 cloud team. So like Bill comes to know about the app cloud. And so when he searches for app hosting, so he somehow finds WS2 Cloud, and he goes to that URL and registers. He only has to provide the email. So he creates an account in WS2 Cloud, and he goes there. So like within minutes, he was able to upload his web application. The other thing, the good thing was, like, he was looking for a database, and the app cloud was provide him the facility to create a database as well. So he was able to create a database and set the parameters in his web app and upload it. Now this screenshot, the part of the screenshot which I have like added here is from the latest app cloud, which I'll talk about in the final part of my talk. So now the app is hosted, and John is somewhat happy because, like, now he's getting more and more requests for cab rides now, because people are. So he did some advertising in the bottom of the TV commercials and all those things. So now he's getting more bookings. So now he thinks beyond like what's at the moment. So he's kind of a visionary guy. And John now wants a mobile app, because like he knows if he has a mobile app, he can reach more customers. Then what John does is he tells Bill, okay, I want a mobile app, please get it done. Not only that, he also wants some analytics on what apps people use most, whether it's the mobile app or the web app, since he wants certain other analytics as well. Now, Bill thought his task was done and he was like going to relax a little bit, but now he has to come up with a mobile app. But Bill is smart. He has written his web app in a way which has a backend and frontend separation. So what he does is he extracts the backend part and deploys it as a RESTful API or RESTful web service in AWS App Cloud, because App Cloud allows you to host JAXA REST services. So now he has the web app and a RESTful service in App Cloud running. Since he wants to track this traffic coming from web app and mobile app, he thought of like he has read about this API everywhere stuff. A lot of people talking about APIs in the conferences and all the other places. He like felt I should make this a managed API. And when he like thinking of an API management solution, it suddenly came to his mind that he has seen this API cloud URL in the AWS cloud when he was going to host his app cloud in App Cloud. Since he has seen that, and he has also received some newsletters from AWS after registering in AWS cloud, he thought of going to the API cloud and giving it a try. So he goes to API cloud. So this is his first experience. When he goes to API cloud, he gets a very convenient interactive tutorial, which helps him to create his first API and publish. So within less than 5 minutes, he has a sample API created and published in the API cloud. So that screenshot is part of that interactive tutorial, where it guides you on creating your API. So then he refers to documentation on what are the other features, what are the other things you can do with API Cloud, and like identifying how I can create my API, how I can create the resources, how I can restrict certain resources to certain people, what are the token generation mechanisms. So he goes through the documentation, and in the documentation it has step-by-step instructions, and it also has. It also has great screencast hosted in YouTube. Then what Bill does is, so he has designed his API previously. So what he now has to do is create the API. He creates the API and publish it. And then he goes to the, there's an API store in the API cloud. He goes to the API store and subscribes to that API by creating two virtual applications. So it has this concept called applications, which are virtual applications. After he subscribes, he has to generate tokens, and he gets two set of tokens. And then he's able to invoke this, invoke his APIs via the API console, which is available in the API store. So now what you see is a piece of that API console, a screenshot of API console, which is in the bottom, and the other one is where you see the subscribe button. I don't think it's visible very much. So this is a screenshot from the API store. Now what he does is, he wants to change his web app to invoke the managed API, and he also now he's writing the mobile app as well. So like he studies a little bit about these auth tokens and how to generate tokens, how to refresh them, what are the grant types you have. So there are like client credential grant type, password grant type, so those kind of things. So then what he does is he thinks, okay, the client credential is what I know, what I need, and he gets the credentials from the API cloud and he embeds it in his web app and the mobile app. So you know these tokens tokens have an expiration time. So he writes his app in a way when the token expires, he refreshes the token using the token API. So this API cloud is powered by the AWS API manager. So it has this token API. Not only the token API, it also has APIs for creating APIs as well. So it has these APIs for managing your stuff. So that kind of a convenience is there. So now he has changed his web app and mobile app to use the managed API. So while doing this, he went through the docs. The docs helped him a lot. But whenever he couldn't find something in the docs, he was like, he was able to get support from the cloud team through submitting support requests or sending the mails to there's a mailing list where you can contact the cloud team. So after getting support, he's now done with the API. So while he was trying these things, the API cloud has a trial period. So another thing which I want to mention is, so in this session, I'll be talking a little bit more about the API cloud, which I'll explain later why. So while he was trying these things, his API was like expiring. Then what he did was he sent a request saying, I want an extension. So the cloud team was happy to extend his trial, and they extended it immediately, and so Bill was able to complete his work. And after he was like satisfied with his work, now he felt, okay, I need to become a paid user in API Cloud, because he can't keep the trial extending all the day, because there are certain limitations. So he talks to John, and he says, like, so there are certain plans in API Cloud. He talks to John, and he like convinces him to upgrade his account to a paid one. So there are certain packages which you can select, the starter one, getting traction, medium, large, and extra large. So they have different features, which are like from the number of API calls you can make, number of users which you can have in your organization, and the TPS and all those things. So he pays through the credit card of John's and upgrades his account. Now he has like relaunched his web application, and mobile app is also submitted to the app stores, and he's able to see statistics in the API cloud on how his API gets invoked. So he can get stats based on subscription, which resource gets invoked most, what's the response time for the resources, when was your API access last, or there's something called the last access time. So he gets a lot of stats on how his API gets invoked. There are certain stats in App Cloud as well. I'll come to that later. Now, John is very impressed with his work. Now, he wants third parties also to use his API. He wants the travel sites and the hotels, all those things, to book rides with him via his API. And he wants to advertise his API. But before advertising, he wants to do certain stuff, like he wants to customize his API URL and his API store. So the API Cloud allows you to use custom URLs for your API and the API store. So John has already bought the johnscaps.com domain. So he goes to the API Cloud and do some configuration. So his API URLs look like they're coming from his domain. And his API store also gets that the API store.johnscaps.com URL. He also wants, now since he has a web app, he also wants this API store, his API store, to look like his website. So he tells that to Bill, and Bill designs a theme which matches the site, so something similar to that one. By simply uploading the theme, you can customize your API store. So the John's API store is now advertised to the parties which are interested in using the API. And now they have gone through the API, and they are also now interested in using this API. So they want to sign up to the API store because they want to generate tokens. And for this, there is something called the subscriber self-sign-up feature, which Bill enables. And then the self-sign-up request now, they are coming, and they need to be approved by Bill or John. So then the third parties are able to sign into the API store, generate tokens, and invoke APIs. So now, while this was going on, like Bill had to improve his API. He wanted to add new methods, do certain improvements. So what he did was, like, he creates different versions of API. So the API Cloud allows you to have multiple versions. And then in the App Cloud, he created different versions of app, and he pointed those apps to the different versions of API. But he always has a default version of the app and API, which the traffic is routed. But he can test the apps and APIs in using the other versions as well. So now John is happy because his business is growing. He gets a lot of requests for cab rides, and he has now expanded the business, and he has bought some new cab taxis and as well. The thing is, it only costs Bill's salary and just $100 per month. Bill is happy because he doesn't need to worry about the maintenance. Although he doesn't need to worry, he has configured some pingdom kind of checks to make sure his app and API are running all the time. And he gets a good salary as well because he has performed exceptionally well thanks to the WSO2 Cloud. So that's the story of John and Bill. And so I will speak a little bit about like what's happening, what's coming next in cloud. Now, so I told you that I am going to concentrate a little bit more on the API Cloud, because now we had the App Cloud and API Cloud running for a couple of years. API Cloud is in commercial, but the App Cloud was in beta. And this App Cloud has a lot of features, such as it provided you source code repositories, code editors, build mechanisms such as Jenkins, and then lifecycle management of the apps and all those things. But recently, we decided that the App Cloud should be playing more a supportive role than a major role. And the team which was developing App Cloud, they came up with this new App Cloud, which you can access through that URL, which is not quite public, but it was used in yesterday's tutorial. Sorry. So this allows you to like host Java web apps, Java microservices, and PHP applications at the moment. But in a very short time, maybe like a month or so, we'll be switching this one with the old one. So this one will become the latest App Cloud, and we'll be adding more and more app types. So you will be able to host Node.js applications or any kind of application. So we'll support. So this uses Docker to host your application. So whenever you upload an app, a Docker instance is started, and that's how your app gets deployed. So we'll be supporting your own Docker images as well in the future. So keep an eye on App Cloud, because it will be evolving very rapidly. And so API Cloud, I said it was powered by API Manager. And these days we are working on upgrading it to API Manager 1.10, which is the latest release. So one of the major features we are going to add is the API monetization support, which means you have your API, people are subscribing to it, and they are invoking your APIs. The monetization support means you can bill your users, so bill your subscribers for using your API. So that's coming up in the API Cloud. So with that, maybe John can start billing the API subscribers. So that's pretty much. And also, for the WS2 Cloud, with this year, we'll be adding we are planning to add the Identity Cloud and the Device Cloud. So with the Identity Cloud, you will be able to use WS2 Identity Server in the cloud for different scenarios, such as a single sign-on, federated authenticator, those kind of things. Because like a lot of customers and users, they come and like ask, OK, I want to try your Identity Server. Isn't it available in the cloud? And they're asking for to try the ESB in the cloud. So we'll be adding the integration cloud as well, which will be the ESB as a service, which all of this will be added this year, most probably. So then if we add the Identity Cloud next year, I can talk about how John used the Identity Cloud to enable SSO for his app. OK, so this is Bill. I want you to be like Bill. And if you have any questions, you can ask now.